In this session, I want to tell you about this monograph, The Politics of Sanskrit Studies. First of all, it is a work in progress. So what this is basically a progress report of sorts of what I've been doing for the last couple of months. I will try to tell you in brief of the issues that I have dealt with and the way in which I have dealt with them. So it will give you a rough idea of the sort of work that it is. So first of all, there are in total 17 essays that Sheldon Pollock has written exclusively on the Ramayana. This is apart from his translation of the original work. Naren just showed us that Pollock uses a three-dimensional philology to make sense of texts. We can understand this better when we look at the Ramayana, at Pollock's Ramayana, because this is essentially an application of that tool. So the 17 essays can be divided into three parts. A few of his essays are his plain one reading of the Ramayana. A few of his essays are his plain two readings of it. Some others are his plain three readings of it. So what I have done is dealt with his plain one reading in my first chapter, his plain two reading in my second chapter, and his plain three reading in my third chapter. The fourth chapter is a proposed one. I have not finished it. I will come back to that later. So let me quickly recap what Sheldon Pollock's three-dimensional philology is, so it will help me to move forward. So he says that every Western Indologist who has studied the Ramayana has approached it in one of two ways. In the first method, the Indologist starts from an assumption that the epic is not the work of any one poet. No one can write unaided a work of 25,000 shlokas. So it is unquestionably a compilation to which writers have added from time to time as it pleased them. So the result, this work of 25,000 shlokas, is naturally a confused assemblage of heterogeneous matter originating from different hands at different time periods. V.S. Sukthankar very sarcastically, very beautifully writes, plain one, basically, that is his plain one philology. It begins with the assumption that the nucleus was unfortunately used or rather misused by wily priests, tedious moralists, and dogmatizing lawyers as a convenient peg on which to hang their didactic discourses, sacerdotal legends. It is a great pity that a fine heroic poem, which may even be found to contain precious germs of ancient Indian history, should have thus been ruined by its careless custodians. But it is not quite beyond redemption. A skillful surgical operation, technically called higher criticism, could still disentangle the submerged epic core from the adventitious matter. So basically, these Indologists, they sought to identify an epic nucleus, some one great and complex action embedded though transformed within the ample tapestry of the Ramayana. Most of their researches, consequently, were attempts to cut away the fantastic, the winding disquisitions, the complex didactic matter, in order to restore the original story, perhaps a somber heroic tale of love, loss, and recovery. Plain three philology, or modern philology, on the other hand, are mostly focused on the topic of folk and vernacular versions of the Rama story, in which the hegemonic discourses of patriarchy and social hierarchy of Valmiki's Ramayana are contested or resisted in a variety of subaltern and or regional retellings. In other words, modern critics of the Ramayana fixate on identifying elements of gender, power, hierarchy, and authority in it. Contrarily, Sheldon Pollock is in a league of his own. He does not want to simply engage with the Ramayana on plane one. He does not want to engage with it on simply plane three. What he wants to do then is, first of all, add a plane two to the list, which he calls traditionist philology, or how the tradition made sense of the text, and then engage with the Ramayana on all three planes. So to Pollock, there are three potentially radically different dimensions of meanings to a text: the original authors, the traditions, and the presentists. And each of these meanings are true, none more or less than the others. So philology to him resides in the sum total of the varied senses generated on these three planes and their lively co-presence in our mind. So this in general is his three-dimensional philology. Let us examine each in its turn. So the first chapter I have called Mind of Valmiki. These deals with his introductory essays to the Ayodhya Kanda, because these are his plain one readings of the Ramayana, where his attempt is to theorize about the original nucleus of the story, his attempt to reconstruct psychologically and historically the original author's mind. In order to actualize this, he situates the Ramayana in its purported moment of genesis. He writes, "The meaning and significance of the Ayodhya Kanda will come into focus more readily if we view the story against the background of other ancient Indian epic narratives and locate those narratives in their historical context. Just as, according to the first rule of interpretation, we determine the signification of a word in reference to the words surrounding it, so the literary text can be viewed as a semantic entity that acquires specific meaning in reference to the texts in which it is embedded. The literary genre, for example, and its historical situation." So Pollock's Ramayana, therefore, finds itself betwixt A, other ancient Indian epic narratives, and B, in a dynamic period of transition, the Middle Vedic Age. First of all, I want you to understand that this is how plain one philology works. By imagining what the socio-political conditions might have been when the text might have been composed, the flaws that inhere in this philological mode must be obvious. P.S. Sukthankar again very beautifully says, "Notwithstanding the high-sounding phrases in which it is couched, it is easy to see that this critique cannot give absolutely certain and dependable results, it merely being the exploitation of individual opinion, which selects what it pleases and rejects on insufficient evidence what is incompatible with the preconceived subjective theme scheme. The residue no more represents the original heroic poem than a mangled cadaver lacking the vital elements would represent the organism in its origin or infancy." So in the Monograph, I have first of all critiqued plain one philology, the method that Pollock adopts to come to certain conclusions. And then I have questioned those conclusions themselves. In Shastic debates, we have a word for it, Praudhivada. Say you have built your entire argument on a premise, and I show that premise to itself be faulty, then I do not have to engage in a further argument with you. But I say, okay, let me for a moment forget your faulty premise. I will consider your arguments on their own terms and still show them to be faulty. So this is called Praudhivada, and this is what I have engaged in. I have considered Pollock's arguments on their own terms and tried to show them to be faulty. All his arguments basically lead to one conclusion, that the Ramayana, the central concern of the Ramayana, is kingship. The acquisition, the maintenance, and the execution of royal power, the legitimacy of succession, the predicament of transferring power within the dynasty, etc., etc. All his other arguments are peripheral to it and lead to it in one way or the other. So in the Monograph, I have critiqued every peripheral claim that he has made from authentic sources. And primarily, I have contested the literary and historical situation or context in which he has situated his Ramayana in. Because I do not have the time to go into its details, what I will do is give you an example of each, of one peripheral argument and a central argument. First, I will take up the peripheral argument, that of dynastic struggle. So basically, Sheldon Pollock says that everybody in the Ayodhya Kanda expects Bharata to mount a struggle for power. Dasharatha, Kausalya, Guha, Bharadvaja, and of course, Lakshmana. Because this was the established pattern of behavior. To contest the throne was the established pattern of behavior. This is the claim that he is making. In the Monograph, I have analyzed each one of these instances in their own context, but here I will take up that of Dasharatha. So Pollock's interpretation of Dasharatha's expectation for Bharata to mount a struggle for power is primarily based on these verses. So the situation is that Dasharatha has called Rama and he is informing of his decision that he will be crowned heir prince the next day. And he is saying, Viproshitascha Bharato yavadeva puraditaha tavadeva abhishekaste prapta kalo mato mama. Kamam khalu satam vritte bhata te bharatasthitaha jyeshthanuvarti dharmatma sanukrosho jitendriyah kintu chittam manushyanam anityamiti me matihi satam cha dharma nityanam kritashobhi cha raghava. So Pollock interprets them in order. I believe the best time for your consecration is precisely while Bharata is away. Granted, your brother keeps to the ways of the good, defers to his elder brother, and is righteous, compassionate, and self-disciplined. Still, Raghava, it is my firm belief that the mind of man is inconstant, even the mind of a good man constant in righteousness. Even such a man is best presented with an accomplished fact. So I have reviewed or examined the events that lead up to this situation in particular. We see that in the original text, Dasharatha first calls a council and tells them that he seeks a respite from his kingly duties and wishes to entrust his subjects' welfare to the care of his son, Rama, with, of course, the approval of the Brahmins assembled in court. To this, the assembly applauds the decision and rejoices like peacocks in the rumble of a rain cloud. And because it was the auspicious month of Chaitra, Dasharatha decides to crown Rama as heir prince on the auspicious day of Pushya of the same month. He then tells sage Vasishtha to make the required arrangements and then calls his son and informs him of this decision. Afterwards, after everybody has left the hall, he holds another council with his close ministers. It is then that he is informed that the auspicious day of Pushya falls immediately the next day. So he sends again for his son, for Rama, to inform him of this new decision that he will be crowned the heir prince immediately the next day. Further, he tells him that lately he has been having ominous and inauspicious dreams. And when astrologers were consulted, they told Dasharatha that his birth star is obstructed by hostile planets and he may meet with death or some such misfortune very soon. So Dasharatha is afraid and wants to see his son take the reins of the kingdom before any calamity strikes. We see that Bharata's absence had nothing to contribute to the situation at all, but Pollock repeatedly alludes to these verses to draw attention to some sort of an inner strife within the family. Moreover, here, Viproshitascha Bharato Yava Deva Puraditaha, here where Prapta Kalo, which Pollock translates as the best time, other sources, other translations, or rather the original sources, the commentators translate it as destiny. So basically the verse reads, I think it is destiny that your consecration should take place when Bharata is away. So it is in tone of regret that Dasharatha utters these words, not slyly or craftily. Secondly, kintu chittam manushyanam anityamiti me matihi satamcha dharma nityanam krita shobhi cha raghava. Here he is translating krita shobhi as accomplished fact. By translating it like this, he is blatantly ignoring the epithet shobhi, which literally refers to the splendidness or the praiseworthiness of an act. So essentially, the actual translation will read, O Raghava, it is my opinion that minds of men are inconstant, but a virtuous person like Bharata will only praise a good that has been done, that is the consecration ceremony. So this is in general a sample of how I have dealt with a peripheral argument. I will quickly go on to a central argument, the historical context in which he has chosen to situate his Ramayana in. So he says, according to him, well, major urban cities of Aryan India came into existence in approximately 700 BC, so the 300-400 years following the Middle Vedic Age, were a crucial period in the Indian society. It was at this juncture that some fundamental and lasting transitions occurred in the Indian way of life. One such transition was the extraordinary expansion of the role of the king. So basically, he has placed the Ramayana in a situation where he says kingship was itself a new and a very urgent problem of the time, and which is why all the epic poets were very concerned with what was happening in that period. So Pollock's conclusion rests primarily on three chronological details that in turn rest on the currently distributable Aryan invasion theory and AMT, that A, that the Vedic period extended from 1500 BC to 500 BC, B, that the major cities of Aryan India can be dated to approximately 700 BC, Ramayana was composed in the last centuries BC. I will quickly move on to chapter 2, which is basically his plane 2 reading of the Ramayana. So in his introduction to the Ayodhya Kanda, Sheldon Pollock reconstructs the literary and historical situation of the original Ramayana to demonstrate kingship as a new and in their very nature urgent problem of the time, and therefore a dominant, if the only concern of the text. In his introductory essays to the Aranyakanda, on the other hand, he focuses on the receptive history of the text and its mythical nature to make more forceful his argument. Here, receptive history is basically his plane to philology, which he calls traditionist philology. Generally, the phrase tradition or traditionist philology might conjure to mind an original audience's enjoyment of a poetry. Another scholar actually remarks, the more we learn about actual oral poetries, the more obvious it becomes that the traditional audience of an oral performance, the native speakers, as it were, of the poetry, have, all of them, the mental equivalent of a CD-ROM player full of phrases and scenes. I would go further and say that the full meaning and the full enjoyment of traditional poetry come only when one has heard it all before 100 times in 100 different versions. But Pollock's attempt is neither towards a reconstruction of mental equivalent of a CD-ROM of Indian tradition, nor is it towards a full enjoyment of traditional poetry. So what instead his effort is towards identifying the cause of this or that interpretation. According to him, every interpretation is made possible by something, by some property of the text that allows for it. So every interpretation is evidence of human consciousness activated by the text in its search to make sense of it, in his own words. Since all interpretations are embodiments of human consciousness, which have been called into being by certain properties in the text, such forms of consciousness cannot be correct or incorrect in their historical existence. What we philologists aim to capture when we read along the plane of tradition are those forms themselves. What about the text itself summoned those forms of consciousness into existence? But unfortunately, Pollock's traditionist philology is historicist in its own way. The few references that he makes to tradition, he is only referring to the medieval commentators of the Ramayana. He writes, the commentarial tradition is the closest thing we have to an original audience. Commentators of the Ramayana cannot account entirely for its receptive history. First of all, the Ramayana is a composition in performance. So the performers neither memorize the entire text nor improvise freely. They learn stylized diction, performance styles, themes, and the outlines of the narratives and recombine them before the audience. So the term tradition here refers diachronically to the history and process of transmission, to the rules of the genre, to such conventions as poetic dialect, the formula, the meter, the themes, and actual narratives themselves. In this sense, the tradition constitutes a canon, and such a tradition, such a context is still alive in India today. Whereas Pollock's tradition is located in some historical context, arbitrarily in a medieval era, so it carries with it a foundational element of historicism that is paradoxical and almost self-cancelling. I have, first of all, again criticized or critiqued plane two philology in the monograph, and then again engaged in Praudhivada by analyzing the mythical nature of the Ramayana, which again leads to kingship somehow. So the question that Pollock poses before himself is the unity of the Ramayana. If every Western philosopher or Indologist who actually read the Ramayana thought of the Aranyakanda to be a problematic section of the society, whereas the Ayodhyakanda dealt with the socio-political concerns of the royal family and therefore had a touch of reality to its narration, the Aranyakanda was simply fantastic for them. Contrarily, the original audience or a traditional audience has never felt the said discontinuity between the different sections of the text. So Pollock proposes to start his reading of the Ramayana from a different point, from a traditional a priori, that the Ramayana is not made of two heterogeneous parts, but is actually, in fact, a unified whole. From here, the task of the philologist then would be to ponder on how the two parts fit together or how the Ramayana functions as a unified whole. And the answer that Pollock himself provides is by considering the Ramayana as a myth of the Northrop Frye variety. He writes, let us first recognize the Ramayana as a myth of the Northrop Frye variety. Northrop Frye now was a scholar of romance in English literature, and he defines myth in contrast to the romance as the difference between the mythical and the fabulous is a difference in authority and social function, not in structure. If we were concerned only with structural features, we should hardly be able to distinguish them at all. So according to Pollock, if the Ramayana is considered as a myth that performs the social function of portraying the nature of kingship, the Aranyakanda can also be demonstrated to carry the same social function and thus be taken to form a meaningful part of the whole Ramayana. Now, problems abound in this analysis. First of all, he commences to start the study of Ramayana from a traditional perspective, but midway he exchanges it for a Western one. Tradition has always seen the Ramayana as an itihasa, so one would expect plaintive philology to engage in a deeper or a subtler understanding of what an itihasa is. Secondly, I studied Northrop Frye's works extensively to see that Pollock's Ramayana does not even fit properly into Frye's definition of a myth. To Northrop Frye, a myth is usually a story about the acts of gods. It informs its society, of which it is a part, of its gods, its traditional history, the origin of its customs, structure, etc. Basically, these are myths of creation, of exodus, of migration, of apocalypse, which tell us why we are here, where we are headed. It is a society's vision of the universe and its own place in it. Pollock thoroughly misuses Frye's myth by quoting him narrowly and saying that a myth should only carry a social function to be called one, whereas Northrop Frye's definition of a myth's social function is extremely rigid and Pollock's nature of kingship will simply not fit in. But proceeding from here, Pollock proposes to examine the nature of this social function, the nature of kingship, by examining the nature of Rama, a king. Not according to tradition, but according to, he claims, the text itself. So we know that in Valmiki's Ramayana, Ravana had, through his tapasya, earned a boon that made him invulnerable to all divine and semi-divine beings. He had not bothered to ask for invulnerability from man and other lower forms because to him it would be superfluous. In his eyes, they were weak or harmless. So a god could not slay Ravana because of the boon. A mere man could not possibly slay Ravana because he was too weak. By the logic of the narrative itself, Pollock says that Rama is not merely man, not merely god, but an intermediate being, a god-man who is more than man but less than god. So Rama is god-man, Rama is king, though not technically, he was not crowned, his Pattabhishekha was stopped midway. But therefore, king is God-man. This is his logic generally. I want you to see exactly what he has done. At the beginning and end of the volume, Rama encounters the two evil monsters. He's referring to Viradha and Kabandha, imprisoned in horrific forms as a result of curses. And immediately thereafter, two people of extraordinary holiness, here Sharabhanga and Shabari. The king slays the monsters, thereby releasing them from their confinement and allowing them to recover their proper place in heaven. Both Sharabhanga, the ascetic, and the mendicant woman Shabari commit ritual suicide after their encounter with Rama. Sharabhanga had put off departing for the world of Brahma, which he had won by his asceticism until he had experienced Rama. But now that we have met, he tells the king, I will go to the highest heaven, where the gods reside, whereupon he immolates himself. Shabari has also been waiting for Rama, having been told by her gurus, one day Rama shall come to this holy ashram of yours. You are to receive him. Once you have beheld him, you shall go to the highest imperishable worlds. By direct intervention then, or by his mere presence, Rama, the one to whom all creatures pay homage, offers freedom from the miseries of this world. For the holy ascetic and mendicant, there is nothing further to live for, having once experienced him. The darshana of the divine king functions as both the ratification of their holiness and the mechanism of their release. The evil monsters, for their part, are cleansed by the royal punishment exacted by Rama and so made fit for heaven. When men who have done evil deeds are punished by the king, they are purified and go to heaven just like men of virtue. it is not really clear if Rama is divine by virtue of the boon motive, that is of Ravana's boon, or because of his nature of being a king, really. So basically, I have examined the Puranic tradition and the Agama tradition to explore the nature of Rama, traditionally an avatara. Avatarana is literally a crossing down, the divine or the incarnation or descent of the divine person. It is interesting to know that the very word avatarana is used in reference to the entry of an actor upon a stage, an appearance from behind the curtain, a manifestation that is analogous to the avatara on the world stage. I have also examined the nature of the kingship itself, the divinity of kingship from the original Vedic mantras as well as Dharma Sutras. I will quickly go through this. So a king is divine or becomes divine after his anointment. That is, it is conferred upon him. He is not born into it. The word god Indra is the natural prototype of the warrior king, and a verse in the earliest Veda addressed to Indra is in the later Atharva Veda transferred to the king. Following this lead, the ritual literature identifies the king with several divinities. He is anointed with the glory of fire god, with the radiance of the sun god, and with the power of Indra. But even in the account of the ritual, it is clear that in ordinary belief and parlance, a king is still a human being as distinct from a divine being. For example, to illustrate the honor paid to the god Soma as king and guest, it is casually said that Soma, the divine king, should receive what is due as a guest. For when a human king comes as a guest, they kill an ox for him. Royal divinity is recognized as a matter of form useful to statesmen. Vashishta Dharma Purana says the taint of impurity does not fall on kings because they occupy Indra's place, that is, for the convenience of legal procedure, the king who presides at the court of law is to be considered free from all from the many impositions of ritual impurity attaching to other men. Further, we see most law books make a natural verbal distinction between king, gods, and Brahmins. So when Gautama speaks of witnesses giving an oath in the presence of Deva, Raja, Brahmana, Samsadi, so Apastamba separates the verbal abuse of gods from that of the kings, as if king were not a god, Purusham, Devatanam, Rajnishya, etc. King as a great divinity wearing a crown symbolic of his divine glory is recognized from the Vedic period as a matter of daily practice and belief. However, neither epic nor drama treat the king as a god. He's called Deva, but his divinity stops with the title till he appears officially. When the king doffs his official robes and appears among other men at receptions, in sport or in battle, no one recognizes him in a supernatural way, and the epic, he is seldom honored even perfunctorily with the polite Deva. I have therefore distinguished between the divinity of Rama, which is not more than man and less than God. He's fully man, fully God, hypostatic human. But, well, that is a sample of, again, how I've dealt with plane 2 philology. We'll quickly move on to plane 3. This deals with only one essay, Ramayana and Political Imagination in India. Okay. So on September 25, 1990, L.K. Advani started on a Ram Ratha Yatra from Somnath to Ayodhya to call for the rebuilding of the Ram Mandir in Ayodhya. His Ratha, which resembled Arjuna's in the teleserial Mahabharata, was welcomed very enthusiastically with cries of Jai Shri Ram. It did much for national unity, but it is said that, well, it catalyzed the events that followed 2 years later. So Sheldon Pollock's Political Imagination in India, that essay, basically commences with Advani's Ratha Yatra. In what follows, he tries to show how the Ramayana, a heroic tale of love, loss, and recovery, could be invoked to empower the politics of the present. From historic sources, three historic sources basically, archaeological, epigraphical, and literary, he tries to show how the Ramayana imaginary, which is basically an idea of Rama as the destroyer of Rakshasas, came to occupy a public political space from the 12th century onwards. That is when India faced a cultural and political confrontation with the Muslims or the Turks. Well, at this convenient juncture, he says the Hindu rulers invoked the Ramayana again and cast themselves in the role of Rama and the others as Rakshasas, and this trend continues today. Furthermore, he says that Valmiki's Ramayana itself contains within its narrative elements that allow the EC deployment of itself for political purposes, and it was for this reason that it was cast as a political tool in the 12th century, and it is for this reason that it continues to be cast today. To summarize Pollock's views, A. Valmiki's Ramayana allows for the divinization of political order and the demonization of the other. From the 12th century onwards, simultaneous with the appearance of the others, it came to be employed in equations of politics and power. Kings could be portrayed as the divine King Rama and the outsiders were Rakshasas. For this reason, it continues to be deployed today for dangerous Hindu-Muslim politics. So Pollock cites three evidences in support for his stand: archaeological, epigraphical and textual, which I have examined all. So in archaeological evidence, that is his first evidence, he has just three instances to quote to show that Rama's temples were cultivated as royal cults during this period under examination, that is 12th century to 14th century. I have 10 examples to show otherwise. A cursory list of royal cults developed within this period shows Brihadeshwara and Gangaikonda Cholapuram were the royal cult centers of Rajaraja Chola and Rajendra Chola of Tamil Nadu. The coins and epigraphs of the Kadambas consistently referred to Sri Saptakotishwara as their deity. The Shilaharas always invoked Mahalakshmi in their inscriptions. The Chalukyas and Vagelas of Gujarat considered Somnath as their most important deity. In Rajasthan, the site of Ekalinga emerged as a major center of royal cult in the kingdom of Guhilas of Mewar. In Orissas, the Bhandras worshipped Shiva and Stambishwari and Jagannatha, etc. Well, epigraphical evidence, again, he has just two to quote for his defense. But I have showed that in the medieval epigraphs, whether in the context of Yavana raids or otherwise, the king had many identities, that of Indra, Vishnu, Trivikrama, Mahavaraha, Shiva, Prithu, Agastya, Kama, Revanta, Yudhishthira, Bhima, Rama, etc. The use of Rama and his ideal rule were a part of a complex of motifs, and there's hardly any reason to show the precedence of one over the other in the very inscription that he has quoted. There is also a reference to Arno Raja as the founder of Vaghela line as imitating the feats of Krishna. His adversary Ranasimha, slain on the battlefield, is called Ravana. Lavana Prasada, victor over Turushka king, is mentioned to be more famous than Yudhishthira. His son is called Dasharatha, Kakustha, etc. In the monograph, I have shown other examples from the same period to show that the Rama motif is not really a very common one. There's everything really. Revanta, Udayana, Bhima, Rama, Indra, Vishnu, Madana, Prithu, Shiva, and everything else also. Pollock has arbitrarily isolated Rama from a variegated host of divinities and craftily avoided reference to the others. He has again two textual evidences in support of his stand, that of Merutunga's Prabandha Chintamani and Jainka's Prithvi Raja Vijaya. I have again culled from other literary sources during the same period, for example, in the Madhura Vijaya, which also deals with the war between a Hindu ruler and the Muslims, where throughout the text there's absolutely no mention of Rama at all. It's Vishnu, Gajasura, Shiva, etc. The motives that are being used is just so many, really. And furthermore, the demonization of Muslims that he is talking about, even in his Prithvi Raja Vijaya, is not extraordinary, because if you have a cursory look at every literature of Indian text, you will see that all the enemies are treated alike. I've just taken one example of Pada Taditaka of Shyamalaka, where we see the character, the Dinnis, the Saurashtras, Yavanas are all compared to monkeys, and here is a man with the face of a he-goat, etc., etc. They're all treated alike. It's not that we had a special vengeance towards the Muslims in particular. I have also shown that Muslims were not universally reviled. Representations of Muslims generally oscillated depending on the prevailing political conditions. In times of military conflict and radically fluctuating spheres of influences, the rhetoric is often negative in tone, but whereas a long-established Yavana ruler is consistently assimilated into the Sanskritic political imagination, if that. So in one representation, the destroyer of the Yavana is compared to Vishnu. In another, the Yavana himself gives succor to Vishnu, who, leaving the burden of preservation to the ruler, resides in his Kshira Sagara very happily. Pollock's method of isolating references relating to Rama from their larger context has a greater effect, or exaggerating their effect, is what I have tried to show in plane 3 philology. I have a plane 4 philology, fourth chapter, where I have proposed an alternate philology to make sense of texts like the Ramayana. But this in general is the work. I want to thank Rajiv Ji for giving me the opportunity, the support, and really for everything, and Kannan sir and Mia ma'am for everything that you've done for me. Thank you so much.
This is not a question, but a general comment. See, then what is the medicine for Pollock? See, in Tritiyadhyaya of Sushruta Samhita, there is Garbhini Vyakaranam and Sharira Vyakaranam. Vyakaranam means Vistaraha. Scanning we call CT scan, etc. That is there. So Sushruta initially says, Kimadhishthanam, what is the base of your medical or surgical science? Manas Shariranca. So here both are in the problem. For this gentleman, both are in problem. So first of all, you should send him for Sharira Vyakaranam and Mano Vyakaranam. You please, all of you may add this in your papers and send it to him. But you can quote me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for a wonderful paper. I think what your monograph and Narendra's monograph are showing is that Pollock is using a postmodern idea, postmodernist idea of psychoanalysis of the author. So he's actually analyzing Valmiki, and that is a technique which allows them to insinuate an intention and a motive, whether that person agrees or not. So if a psychoanalyst like Wendy Doniger or Pollock, they're all from similar kind of thing. If they were talking to you, they would say, we think you are an abused, you've been abused as a female, and you are therefore reacting this way. I mean, they'll just insinuate some theory and a motive, which can't be proven. And the burden of proof falls on you, and then they'll accuse you that it's normal, you're defensive, then they'll further psychoanalyze. So this is a very deep kind of disease in the postmodernist. It's a very dangerous device to use against colonized people, because it's the colonizer who gets to interpret you. So now they're interpreting, Wendy Doniger interpreted deities in this way, and gurus, you know, Sri Ramakrishna and Vivekananda and so on, and she started a whole thesis theory, a whole school like that. And Pollock is basically reinterpreting old texts by psychoanalyzing Valmiki and all those people. That's really what they're, right. This three-dimensional, would you agree that that's really what it is? So, I psychoanalyzed Wendy Doniger in my early book. That, you know, why a woman of a certain background would feel this way, why she has to go around the world and talk about this to other people, what is her motive? I'm insinuating motives for her, which they consider to be an ad hominem attack. So when a psychoanalysis is done of the Western scholar, it's an ad hominem attack. But when a psychoanalysis is done by the Western scholar of our deities and our ancient scholars, then it is kind of like philology. Okay, so you can say that philology is a disguised ad hominem attack on our texts and the authors, but because it comes under the veneer of very scholarship work and a lot of use of Western theories and dense language that few of our people can understand, it is meant to impress and bring awe into the Indian westernized post-colonial scholars who will say, wow, this is so great. And since they don't know the texts themselves, it has worked. So this trick has worked for a very long time, you know, very long time. So I think the work you guys are doing, both of you, is of a historic nature. And this is the beginning of a whole new reversing the gaze that you are doing. So after that experience with Doniger, I also started my own psychoanalysis of Pollock and how to situate him in the social political world that he comes from, because he's situating the Ramayana in that way, so I can apply the 3D philology on him. Okay, thank you.